Glory be to God on high.
And on earth, peace to the will towards heaven. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for our great glory. O Lord our God, heaven and King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of God, that takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takes away the sins of the world, receive our prayers. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and the tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds and power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They're filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea, all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what is spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. That will show portents in the heaven above, and signs in the earth below. Blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with the sighs too deep for words, and God, who searches the heart, knows what the mind of the Spirit knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
With our spirit.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom will I send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father? He will testify on my behalf. You are also to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you ask me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Today, we have heard of the many wondrous things which occurred in Jerusalem 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus. Jesus died and rose again from the dead. The disciples had not fully understood, and so they were afraid and closed themselves up together in one place. The disciples were waiting, and Jesus had instructed for the Holy Spirit to come to them. Jesus had promised that after the resurrection, he would send the Holy Spirit. In fact, while they were praying together, they saw something which seemed like flames of fire descending upon each of them, and they were transformed. They went out to tell everyone that Jesus had risen. Did you know that fire transforms? What is cold becomes warm, and what is hard becomes soft. What is dark becomes bright or luminous. The Holy Spirit transforms us with his gifts. brings gifts to each of us. Isaiah prophesies about the gifts of the Spirit of the Lord.
Thank you. Miss Sally, come and claim your gift. Which gift do you want to claim today? All right, go around to the front. The gift of understanding. Miss Anna Weeds. Which gift of the Holy Spirit would you like to claim today? Understanding. The gift of understanding. Miss Eudora. Which gift would you like to claim today? The gift of wisdom. Miss Helen, which gift would you like to claim today? Fear of the Lord.
After the final procession, we invite you to come and choose your own gift from the bowls of stones that we have here next to it where the children are sitting. They are found here, right here next to the pulpit. Let us pray. Almighty God, who sent his Son Jesus, the Good Shepherd, to watch over your sheep, and just as the Father, the Vine Lord, prunes the vine in order that the branches might yield much good fruit, we ask you lead us as we care for these children which have sent us a good sentence. Give each of us calm strength and patient wisdom, that we may teach them to love whatever is just and true and good, following the example of the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you together in the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. Amen.
For families with school-age children, it also means final exams, End of year parties, sports team banquets, recitals, performances, playoffs, Boy Scout dinners, and more. I can't even list it all. As a mother of two, I have to confess that despite the many difficulties of quarantine, homeschooling, and all of the uncertainties last spring, there was a part of me breathing a sigh of relief and respite from the hustle. Any other moms feel that way? I see some heads nodding, yes. Don't get me wrong, I missed being with people. I missed celebrations, parties. I missed being here with y'all at church. It was profoundly difficult to exist during the months of lockdown, but there was a certain peace in being at home with my family, abiding with them rather than by their schedules. This year is very different. Things are nearly back to normal. Praise God for vaccines. But I am both relieved and exhausted. Right in the middle of all these things falls Pentecost, a celebration of the precious gift of the Holy Spirit and the gifts that he offers to us. While this is an important day in the life of the church, it's as important as Christmas and Easter, okay? It's a big deal. It often seems to be lost in the flurry of activity of things that we are doing. And it hasn't been commercialized yet, so it's not as much on our radar. I say yet because there's always going to be something. So Pentecost was originally an Old Testament observation, a post-Passover harvest celebration, a gathering of the faithful. When the disciples gathered in Jerusalem for Pentecost that year following the ascension, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they were able to speak and understand many languages. In a sense, on that day, the Holy Spirit sent forth the first ever mission team. How many of you have ever been on a mission trip? I know you have over there. Ellison, you were four, but we'll let that count. I see Lisa in the back where you're in. He sent those disciples out to fulfill the great commission given by Christ himself. Go and make disciples of all nations. Christians the world over are to this day following that commandment. So this ancient celebration of the harvest has become a celebration of the harvest of souls, so to speak. When I was growing up here in Charleston, this area was very different. Even when I was a student at the College of Charleston in the early 90s, I mean, I was a very, very young college student. I was like 12. The neighborhoods around the Church of Holy Communion were vastly different than they were today. Who was living in Charleston then? Do you remember? When Jonathan and I got married only 20 years ago, child bride, we lived just up the way in Wagner Terrace. We moved to West Ashley in 2004, but we still have ties to the old neighborhood. Eudora goes to school there. Ellison used to. Jonathan teaches nearby. We all have friends there and often visit. And just in that 16 years since we moved away, there's been tremendous change and growth in that neighborhood. Midtown and Uptown Charleston have dramatically changed in my lifetime. The schools are no longer completely segregated. There is still work to do. There are community gardens, a handicap accessible playground. Schools that sat and rotted for decades have been rebuilt and reimagined. Food Lion is no longer the only grocery store north of the crosstown. Okay? That is a very big deal if you live north of the crosstown. Fancy hotels and amazing restaurants have sprung up in areas that used to feature weed-filled vacant lots and the college ghetto. We are most assuredly here in the midst of a dynamic, vibrant, and growing community. How many of you, I just want to know, sitting here at church today, live within a mile or two of the church? Okay, I see a few hands. Don't worry, I'm not suggesting that you move, and I'm not faulting you for commuting to church. I commute to church. I'm thankful for each and every one of you, and I have to take this time to say, I missed your faces last year, but more than that, I missed your hugs. My point is that with all of those singles and couples and families living nearby, we should have more locals in the pews. Now, we do outreach here. The food pantry helps many people in need. We have a number of members active in the Charleston Justice Ministry, which has become increasingly more important to our city and her people in the last few years. We have a day school that serves families in the area. We have a youth group that is growing against all odds when it shouldn't be growing in a pandemic. But the kids are bringing their friends. They need community. They are tired of Zoom. They need to be together. Some of the kids started high school this year and their schools stayed virtual the whole year. They have not had a chance to meet anyone at school. Christine Jennings shared a compelling article with me yesterday. Just Church by Greg Seiler was published by the Episcopal Church Foundation. In his essay, Seiler poses the question, how can we say we are a just church when we don't actively incentive developing new ministries among those persons and communities who have been systemically undervalued and altogether marginalized? He goes on to say that he's not talking about outreach, but about true community engagement and building relationships. People, our church is in the perfect place to do that. We have homeless people who literally sleep on our sidewalk and gather in the bus stop out front. There are people steps away from us whose homes are falling down around them. They have no means to fix them. There are seniors living alone. So many people who have been undervalued and marginalized. They need more than financial assistance. They need love and friendship. They need to feel wanted, just like me. They need hugs. They need neighbors. I'm always touched when a member of the nearly 10,000 strong Wagner Terrace Facebook group, instead of arguing about things, posts an inquiry about a neighbor or a homeless person known to favor that in a town, but they haven't seen them in a while. Responses of sightings happen almost instantly. I gave him breakfast on Tuesday. He was asleep on the bench in the park last weekend. I noticed he had new shoes this morning. Look, these neighbors are doing the work of the church. Whether they go to church or not. Right there amidst the homeless folks, the solo seniors, the hungry, those needing justice, are the thousands of families who are financially sound, living in lovely new and restored homes, and supporting all of the restaurants and shops. Guess what? They need outreach too. That is community involvement and relationship building. Whether they are college students, seniors, families with young children, transplants from Ohio, newlyweds, or food and beverage workers, they need Jesus. We are willing to give food, medical assistance, and donations to help the needy. But are we willing to go out on a limb, leave our comfort zones, and invite people to join us? Are we willing to speak their languages? Who's got a cell phone? I want to see more hands than that. Show me your phone. Everybody show me your cell phone. I'm serious, pull it out of church. No one's going to tell you. All right, we're going to practice reaching out to people just to get us started. I'm going to give you three options, and I want you to choose one and do it right now. I'll wait. One, take a selfie. Make sure people can tell you're in a church. Post it to your social media. Check in to your Church of the Holy Communion and have a caption reflecting that you're in church this morning. I usually post celebrating the risen Lord, or I'm a church, want to share my pew? You can come up with something. Why are the cell phones going away? Get back out. Look around. Thank you, Lord. Do you notice someone who isn't here today, but used to be a regular worshiper? Do you have their phone number? Text them. And I mean right now. Tell them to get dressed, join us in the Pentecost party after church. There's cake, all right? It's delicious. There's hot dogs. There's a craft. Or invite you to come next week. Three, more cell phones are going away. I've seen them going to pockets. Text a friend that doesn't attend church the Holy Communion. Tell them you're sitting in church right now and thought of them and invite them to join you on a Sunday morning. I don't see a whole lot of people looking at their phones. I'm encouraging you to look at your phone right here at church. I know this is out of the comfort zone for a lot of you, most of you, all of you. I suspect that lots of you are going to just keep those phones in your pocket. But I pray that if you don't take this opportunity now, that the Spirit will keep nudging you, keeping it in your mind until you do. Consider this. Empty pews represent an empty kingdom. And if that doesn't get you in the feels, empty pews represent empty collection plates. Each one of the gifts of the Spirit represents an opportunity for us to grow in our faith and strengthen our bond with God, whether it's understanding, fear of the Lord, piety. Moreover, they empower us to embody and share the gospel. To the children that came up here today, the gifts merely reflect the love that the Good Shepherd has for them, presented in a meaningful and tangible way. And they are also an invitation for them to wonder, which is the foundational tenet of Catechesis of the Good Shepherd. Now, as I've already said, and we've heard in the readings, Jesus did tell the disciples that the Holy Spirit was coming. He just left a little bit out of the description. Our passage from Acts says that the Holy Spirit came upon them like a mighty rushing wind, and tongues of fire appeared over them. In today's gospel, he calls the Holy Spirit an advocate and the Spirit of the truth. He did not mention blazing fire. Fortunately for us, the disciples recovered from the shock, took the gift that had been bestowed upon them, pulled out their cell phones, no mistake, and went out into the street, declaring the wonders of God to everyone, each in their own language, and then they continued to do so for the rest of their lives. The power of the Holy Spirit is a great and mysterious thing. It is something that our tiny little human brains have a great difficulty understanding, which is why that's one of the gifts. But understanding is not as important as welcoming and accepting. The Holy Spirit fills us to overflowing with love and power in a virtually indescribable way. As small and insignificant as we are, the Holy Spirit can be so much more and still live within us. Because of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we are able to accomplish great things in the name of God. That amazing day of Pentecost is often referred to as the birth of the Christian church. We'll celebrate God today. There's a birthday cake. Today we celebrate our faith. We have gathered together to worship and share the Eucharist. We will join together in fellowship and to share cake. We are also celebrating being together, worshiping, enjoying fellowship, together in person. To that end, we will find some paper doves for the celebration outside. They are not for the kids, they are for everyone. Please take one, color it, write your name upon it. They will be cut out and displayed together to represent our community, united in the Holy Spirit and together. When we finally part company today, it is my prayer that each of us, in our own way, will work to fulfill the Great Commission by sharing the gospel with others, through words or through actions, and by asking the Holy Spirit to fill us with the power of love that others can see reflected in our eyes. It isn't always easy to share the gospel, and some might find it scary or uncomfortable. Some might worry they won't be good at it, but that is precisely why we have an advocate, a helper, a Spirit of truth. We don't have to do this alone. And you can start small. Become a part of the justice ministry. Mary Neal and Jane are here. Any other representatives of Charles Mary Justice Ministry here? Christine? Speak to one of them. Who works with Food Pantry? Food Pantry always needs more volunteers. Speak to Sue about volunteering in the atrium. I guarantee you will learn something about your faith you never knew. Talk to Kathy about volunteering in the nursery. If you can sing, join the choir. We can start small and grow and reach out into the community. And we're not talking about bringing them in here, although that happens. We are bringing here to them. But you're not alone. Get to it. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Fear not, I'm not going to preach a sermon today, but I did have just a few words I'd like to say. I'd like to thank all of you that took a part in this, the grown ones, the little ones. What I think we find out in a Pentecost is that we don't really know the church unless we work in the church. And more importantly, I don't know that we can know God without knowing His work in our lives and our work with Him. So I would leave you with this one thought. Try to recollect and remember your gifts, whatever they are. Have been, they may have changed. You may have many, many, you may not have so many, but don't dare say that you don't have any gifts, because that would be saying that our loving God decided not to give us one, He gave everybody else one. So we know that you've got gifts. Think about what they are and how you can serve the Lord in this church, or in any other place or way. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world and for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our visiting bishop and our bishop-elect, and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our president, for the leaders of the nation, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and community, for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and the infirm, the widows and the orphans, and the sick and the suffering, for Barbara, Matthew, John, Monica, Christian, Sarah, Brad, Sherman, Mary, Katie, Sue, Paul, Meg, Lucia, Bob, Michael, Harold, Bill, Janice, Billy, Anna, Millie, Matt, Crystal, Susan, Ruth, Carol Sue, Leslie, Jim, Nick, Deanna, Lily, Hank, and Kevin, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and destitute, for prisoners and captives, and all who are members who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of Blessed Mary the Virgin, the holy patriarchs, the prophets, the apostles, and the martyrs, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life through Christ our God.
To you, Lord our God.
Thine is the majesty of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever, and unto the ages of ages.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all men, we acknowledge and pray of our manifold sins and sinners, which we from time to time under the sacredness have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. In the midst of your death, in the heart of your sorrow and pity on us,
shall kings bring presents unto thee? Sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseech you to grant your Bible
inheritance in death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, who through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto the Lord ourselves, our souls, and bodies to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseech thee this week and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion, may ever receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and may one body with him that he may dwell in us. And although we are unworthy of our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this unbounded duty of service, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Divine whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath called us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
This holy sacrifice was offered to the glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in Blessed Trinity, with special intention and prayers for the needs and concerns of this congregation. The sanctuary lamb candle was given to the glory of God and in thanksgiving for the cross for left. The altar flowers and the music was given to the glory of God and loving memory of John Philip Howard. Lord, be with you.
And with my spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we must all thank thee, for thou hast saved to feed us, that we will receive these holy mysteries, that the spiritual food and the most precious body and blood of the Son of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
lost 10 people.